Godot Tutorials is not sponsored by or affiliated with the Godot game engine. In this episode, I'll be going over crafting the game experience. My name is Josie and I'll be your guide for this episode. I also have a website at godottutorials.com, so please feel free to check that out. In this episode, I will be going over crafting a game experience, and I will be going over the following. What is the game experience? Why is it important in game design? Game experience versus player experience. The five main game experiences you may end up crafting in games. What is the game experience? First and foremost, the game experience is a term I came up with. Game experience is not to be confused with game structures or even the player experiences. It may just be called the game package or game product. But regardless, the game experience is what I call the entire package of a game and how it can move a player. You must remember that a game is a combination of multiple things put together. And at the end of the day, those things are artfully combined to create a game that hopefully moves the player in some way. It creates a game experience for the player that they will never forget, no matter how much time passes since their last playthrough. Think about a game you played when you were a child. You probably remember it more than other experiences you had as a child. Now, why is that? For me, it's because some games touch you in some way that you never forget the experience of playing that game. In a sense, the reason understanding the game experience is important is because you may end up crafting an experience out of one of five main game experiences. If you focus on crafting on one or a combination of many game experiences, you may end up finding yourself with a game that is memorable to play, which is a good thing. I'm hoping that if you are watching this series, you are looking forward to making a game that is both fun and memorable to play with. So, what exactly is the difference between the game experience and the player experience? Well, in a sense, the game experience is just a vague and higher overview of what encompasses a game and how it can move a player. This is in contrast with the player experience, which focuses on the individual and what we as game designers need to target to get the player to continually involve themselves in a game. I will talk about the player experience in a different episode. Regardless, let's go over the five main game experiences you may end up crafting. Before I begin, keep in mind that there are no hard rules when crafting a game and the game experience. As a matter of fact, you can craft any type of game experience that is only limited by your imagination. With that out of the way, I would like to mention that if you are going to innovate something new and never before seen, you will most likely be trying to innovate on one or a combination of the following. They are the gameplay experiences, the story experiences, the emotional experiences, the immersive experiences, and the social experiences. Let's go over each of them individually so you can get a better sense of each one of these experiences. Let's start with the gameplay experience. The gameplay experience is the most common experience most games have embedded into them. You can build a game that wows a player with the joys of how they play your game. It can be things as simple as the jumping mechanics in Mario, the battle system in Pokémon, or even hopping and timing mechanics of the game Frogger. Or it can be as complex as the game systems found in Civilization VI, Sterilis, and even Hearts of Iron 3. Keep in mind that both simple and complex games are fun to play with to whichever group of players they are targeting. Nonetheless, gameplay experiences have a certain wow factor that keeps players coming back to play the game more. The second type of game experience is the story experience. You can make a game that is linear in story or a game that submerges your players inside a story where every choice you make has consequences to the story you are playing. The story experience can be as simple as a clickable kinetic novel or visual novel, where it's an eternal left-click button game. It may give you the illusion of player choice when in reality your choices have zero impact on the story being told to you. And yet, regardless of its linear storytelling, the story still moves you, or at least to me. In other games, the story can be as complex as the game Mass Effect and the Walking Dead Telltale series, where each choice you make affects the story told to you. In a sense, the storytelling is branching and non-linear. In the Walking Dead game, your choices affect how the story unfolds in real time. No single playthrough gives you the same story unless you make the exact same choices. Sometimes it gives the illusion of choice with zero impact on the story being told, while at other times the decisions you make have dire consequences on the story being told. In a game like Mass Effect, your choices in the game impact how the story unfolds at the end of the game. It's what made it unique and innovative at the time of its release. Last and not least is the games where the stories that unfold are the ones uniquely made by how the player plays the game. Take The Sims 3 game for example. Your character's story is the one based on your decisions. Do you want your character to live a happy life, married and loved by everyone? Do you want your character to live a single life? Perhaps the story for your character is one of a cooking tragedy. The stories you make in Sims 3 are unique to how you play the game. No two stories are the same because no two players are the same. Both types of storytelling in games move people, However, I will admit that there is more playability in branching storytelling games rather than a linear storytelling game. Next on the list is called the Immersive Experience, and it's slightly hard to quantify. Regardless, I will try my best. Some games work to move players emotionally. This may be from both positive and negative emotions, which include happiness, sadness, and the emotion fear itself, which is used in horror games. It can be as something as simple as the game called Passage. It's basically a game where you move to the right. You start off as a young person, but it's what I call a simulation of life. It's a game that can be completed in as little as 5 minutes, but the feeling it leaves behind to you is immense. Who knew something theoretically as simple as the game called Passage could leave a mark in your heart in as little as 5 minutes? Next, you have more complex emotional experiences such as the game Journey for the iOS. In this game, you move through the world like any other game, except what makes this game emotionally memorable are the feelings of the friendships you make in the game, and the rise and fall of a civilization, all without the game saying a single word. That ending, walking through the snow, really moved quite a few people. The best part of it all, the emotional meaning of that game is different to everyone and unique to the individual, because it's an emotion that encapsulates the meaning of your own journey into the game. In a sense, the ending is different for everyone who played it. Finally, we get to the emotion of fear. Horror games have a lot going for them. But to me, the best horror games are the ones that can use the emotion of fear itself to blanket the game's emotional experience. Take, for example, the game Alien Isolation, where the simple fear of not knowing where the alien is will always be an amazing experience to feel. The game does a great job of balancing those fears. Other games that touch on fear with limited vision of your surroundings or opponents include Five Nights at Freddy's, Alan Wake, and Outlast, a game where you need your night vision camera always charged and ready. Regardless of whether a game can be finished in 5 minutes or a few weeks, if made just right, they can move you in such a profound way. The next on the list is what I call the immersive experience. The immersive experience is what I use to describe the feeling of being engrossed in the world you are playing, the character you are playing, or the literal immersive experience itself. For example, immersive experience can be feeling like you are the greatest assassin in the world. Games that immerse you in the assassin experience could be a game like Hitman or Assassin's Creed. Immersion can be a game like Arma 3, where you feel like you are a real soldier, where one single mistake can have dire consequences. It could even be a game like Microsoft's Flight Simulator, where you are engrossed in the experience of being a pilot and flying a plane, where all the real-world rules of physics are applied. But there are other immersive experiences to think about as well, with the emergence of virtual reality and augmented reality games. Take, for example, the augmented reality game Pokémon Go. It's a game where you feel like there is an actual Pokémon standing in your living room. How amazing was that feeling when a Pokémon was standing right in front of you? On top of that, take for example the virtual reality game Half-Life Alyx that can be played on the Oculus Rift. In the first opening of the game, you are standing outside on the roof where there are bottles everywhere. Besides the bottles acting like props to help you get familiar with the controls of the grabbing physics, it does one more important thing: it immerses you in the game. Let me tell you, I pick up bottles all the time in the real world. When I see litter on the street, I try my best to keep it clean and pick it up. What makes picking up the bottles in the Half-Life Alyx game different than picking up bottles in the real world is that in the real world I'm picking up bottles. In the Half-Life Alyx game, I'm picking up bottles inside of the Half-Life Alyx world. How cool is that? Last and not least is the social experience. Sometimes games are better played with others. Games are how we can connect with others in this world, form friendships, perhaps even find love. Regardless, social experiences can be found in many childhood games such as Tag, Hide and Go Seek, and even the children's game House. It could even be a game like the first Pokémon Red game, where you had to have a cable link and connect two Game Boys together to play with your friends. Games allow us to meet one of humanity's greatest needs, the need to feel loved and feel belonging, all of which will be talked about in another episode. Regardless, some games are even played only for the social experiences. These games include World of Warcraft, Final Fantasy XIV, it could even be a competitive game, such as Rainbow Six Siege or even Among Us, where some people only play with friends to relax and have fun. That's basically it for crafting game experiences. Let's look at some homework. I want you to write down your three favorite game and in a quick summary explain which of the five experiences those games have engraved in your heart and mind. It doesn't even have to be the five I mentioned in this episode. The importance of this is to help zone in on some broader themes, which will be delved into much deeper in later episodes. Well, that's all I have for you in this episode. Thank you for subscribing and clicking the like button. Thank you so much for joining me, and I look forward to seeing you in the next episode. Have an amazing day.